Let us discuss questions on disposal of amino groups and urea cycle. First of all, I want to ask you one question. What is the storage form of proteins? Don't say muscles. Proteins are not stored in the body. When you take in excess, they will be destroyed. Okay? Muscles contain protein. That does not mean that it is a storage form. Okay? Answer this question. Transamination is the first step in the catabolism of many amino acids. So, they are giving a fact. All of the following amino acids undergo transamination except. Okay? So, name the amino acids which cannot undergo transamination. Answer is threonine. Okay? And proline. Hydroxyproline. See, threonine and proline. Proline is an amino acid. So, obviously, it cannot undergo transamination. Okay. Very important this question. Amino acids that cannot undergo transamination. Threonine, proline, hydroxyproline. Which of the following amino acids undergoes significant amount of oxidative deamination? Deamination is removal of ammonia. Okay. Oxidative, that means either NADH or NADPH will be produced. Okay. Oxidation, right? Loss of electrons. There should be someone to accept that electron. That can be NAD plus or NADP plus. Okay. So, which amino acid? Glutamate. Okay. That is why the amino group from all the amino acid in the body is carried in the form of glutamate. Okay. Alpha ketoglutarate collects the amino group. Okay. Then it comes to the liver in the form of glutamine. So, if they are asking you all over the body, or generally they are asking which of the following amino acid carries, transports or detoxify ammonia. So, the answer should be glutamate. If they are asking you from muscle, the answer should be alanine. In brain, hyperammonemia is toxic to brain. So, in brain, glutamate takes one more ammonia, okay, to produce glutamine. Clear? Very, very important. Generally, it is glutamate. From muscle, alanine. In brain, it is glutamine. Clear? So, glutamate is the amino acid which undergoes significant amount of oxidative deamination. See, ammonia is released and there is oxidation. There is an unique feature for this enzyme. This enzyme can use either NAD plus or NADP plus as a cofactor. Okay, glutamate dehydrogenase. Okay, this enzyme. What is the fate of this NH3, that is ammonia? It will be converted into urea by the urea cycle. This reaction happens in the hepatic mitochondria. Okay, so in the mitochondria, carbamoyl phosphate synthetase, one enzyme will come. Okay, CPS1 enzyme will come and it will react with this ammonia. So, urea will be produced. Okay, urea cycle happens initially in the mitochondria, then the rest of the steps it will happen in the cytoplasm. Clear? Okay. Which of the following amino acid is the transport form of ammonia from brain to liver? I told you. If they are telling you brain, it will be glutamine. Okay. Which of the following urea cycle enzyme is coded by X chromosome? Otherwise, name an urea cycle disorder which is X-linked. So, that is your hyperammonemia type 2. Okay. That is due to defect in the ornithine transcarbamylase, OTC. Okay, OTC defect is X-linked. So, this is the enzyme ornithine transcarbamylase. So, let us briefly see the urea cycle. So, what is happening? Ammonia, I told you, ammonia is released by the glutamate dehydrogenase reaction. That ammonia reacts with CO2 to produce this carbamoyl phosphate. Okay, carbamoyl phosphate synthase 1. CPS1 is in urea cycle. CPS2 is for pyrimidine synthesis. So this CPS1 is activated by N-acetyl glutamate. Okay, this N-acetyl glutamate synthase, that enzyme is activated by arginine. Remember that also. Then carbamyl phosphate reacts with ornithine to produce citrulline. Okay, these are the two reactions happening inside the mitochondria. Then citrulline comes outside. Okay, then it reacts with aspartate to produce this argininosuccinate. Okay, then there is a lyase reaction that releases fumarate. Now the fumarate can go to TCA cycle. So the link between urea cycle and TCA cycle is fumarate. Okay, so argininosuccinate, lyase produces arginine. Now this arginase, so this is a hydrolysis reaction. Arginase acts on arginine to produce urea and ornithine. Ornithine again goes into the mitochondria back. So ornithine is regenerated. Okay, like your oxaloacetate in the TCA cycle, ornithine is regenerated. Clear? So this we have seen. Which of the following statements about transamination reaction is correct? Transamination reaction. So here, transfer of amino groups. See this, this is a keto acid, this is becoming amino acid. Okay, keto is becoming amino, amino acid is becoming keto acid, that is called transamination. Okay, coupling with ATP hydrolysis is required for transamination. There is no ATP here, so it is a wrong statement. Transamination reactions are irreversible. See this, completely reversible. Wrong. Transamination requires NAD plus or NADP plus. That is your glutamate dehydrogenase reaction. This is not. Require pyridoxal phosphate. Yes. Here it is not shown, but it is required. B6 is involved in transamination reaction. This is a ping pong reaction. Okay. Ping pong bye-bye reaction. Don't go into the details of ping pong bye-bye and all. Just know this. It's a ping pong bye-bye reaction. Okay. Which of the following statements about urea cycle is correct? Okay. Carbamyl phosphate supplies both the nitrogen atoms of urea cycle. Urea in the urea cycle. Where is, if you see the carbamyl phosphate, it produces only one nitrogen. Okay. The other nitrogen comes from aspartate. Okay. So it is the wrong statement. Arginino. This is not argino. This is argininosuccinate is lysed to urea. No. Arginine is lysed to urea, right? Let us see the each and everything. You see carbamyl phosphate. See this carbamyl phosphate. It contains only one nitrogen. So it cannot give both the nitrogen. That is wrong. Argininosuccinate is lysed to urea. It is actually arginine which is lysed to urea and ornithine. So that is also a wrong statement. Formation of urea from the urea cycle yields energy. Can you see where energy is coming? No energy is coming here. Energy is actually required in the urea cycle. Okay. See this 2 ATP, right? 2 ATP and conversion of 2 ADP. Okay. And here is also involvement of ATP. Okay. So energy is, that is also ATP to AMP hydrolysis. So 4 ATP equivalents. 4 ATP equivalents are required. Here 2, here 2. Because ATP is converted into AMP. So that is why we say that 4 ATP equivalents are required. Okay. In the urea cycle. Okay. The formation of urea from the urea cycle yields energy. Wrong statement. Arginine is hydrolyzed to urea and ornithine. So ultimately that is the correct statement. Okay. Regarding the energy requirement of urea cycle, there is a lot of confusion. Don't go into the deep details and all. Okay. Some people say that this fumarate goes, it goes to TCA cycle, it provides energy. Okay. Don't think like this. Okay. Which of the following urea cycle disorder, arginine supplementation should not be done? Okay. There is a disorder, hyperarginemia. Already there is lot of arginine. So, there you won't do arginine supplementation. In others, you give arginine supplementation. Why? For example, arginine is a semi-essential amino acid. Okay. So in urea cycle, already arginine level will be low. And moreover, I told you that N-acetylglutamate, this enzyme, synthesizing enzyme, that is activated by arginine. Okay, so that is why we give arginine supplementation to produce N-acetylglutamate, which in turn will activate CPS1. Okay. So hyperarginemia, don't give arginine. Okay. Triple H syndrome is due to defect in. What is triple H syndrome? Hyperammonemia, hyperarnithinemia, homocystinuria. This is due to defect in the transporter for ornithine. Okay, mitochondrial transporter for ornithine. So ornithine is not coming into the mitochondria, so hyperarnithinemia. Urea cycle is defective, that is why hyperammonemia. Then what is this homocystinuria? From where this is coming? Homocystinuria happens because now ornithine is not available. So carbamoyl phosphate reacts with lysine. Lysine is also a dibasic amino acid. Okay, epsilon amino group is there, right? So carbamoyl phosphate reacts with lysine, which resembles ornithine, to produce homocystinuria. Okay, that is why homocystinuria happens. Clear? Triple H syndrome is due to transporter for ornithine, that is ornithine permease. Okay. What is the minimum number of ubiquitin molecules that must be attached to the target protein for its destruction? So here we are going to discuss about ubiquitin proteasomal system. Let us discuss. Ubiquitin is a small molecule, okay, with just 76 amino acids. Okay. There are three enzymes involved, E1, E2, E3. Okay, the first enzyme is ubiquitin activating enzyme. Okay. So if you see, there is a SH group here. Okay. This ubiquitin activating enzymes activate the ubiquitin molecule, okay, by forming a thioester bond. Okay. So now ubiquitin is activated. Here also ATP is converted into AMP. Two high energy phosphate bonds are used. Now the next enzyme E2 is known as ubiquitin conjugating enzyme. Again, from E1 this is transferred to E2. Okay. Third one is ubiquitin ligase. Third one is ubiquitin ligase. Ubiquitin, which is bound to E2, okay, it is already there. Now the substrate is added to the ubiquitin by the E3. Okay, so E3 is the ligase. Minimum of 4 ubiquitin molecules should be added to the substrate. Okay, where it is added, you can clearly see amino group of the substrate, and you can see this is epsilon amino group, this is epsilon amino group. Which is the amino acid containing epsilon amino group? Lysine. Okay, so there is an atypical peptide bond formation. Usually peptide bond form with alpha carboxyl group and alpha amino group. Here we are forming with epsilon amino group. So it is an isopeptide bond. This is known as isopeptide bond, very important, okay, to the epsilon amino group. Ubiquitin also contains lot of lysine. So again, ubiquitin is attached with another ubiquitin through same epsilon amino group, lysine only. Clear? So after addition of this ubiquitin, now the protein which is targeted for destruction will go to proteasome. Okay. So here the answer will be 4. To which of the following amino acid target protein ubiquitin is added? The one which is having epsilon amino group, that is your lysine. Okay. What is the nature of bond between ubiquitin and the amino acid of the target protein? Atypical peptide bond, that is your isopeptide bond. Polyubiquitinated proteins are destroyed in not lysosomes, it is proteasomes. Okay. Which of the following is a proteasomal inhibitor? You might have studied in medicine, multiple myeloma, bortezomib. To prevent the light chain toxicity, we give bortezomib. It's an inhibitor of proteasome. Okay. Adding just one ubiquitin to a protein won't destroy the protein. Okay. Very important. Sometimes it can even activate the protein. Okay. Ubiquitination is not always for destruction. Histone proteins are ubiquitinated, mono ubiquitinated. Okay. Which of the following amino acid is the source of ammonia in the kidney? So, kidney maintains acid-base balance. Okay. So, in that process, it requires ammonia. Okay. So, by which protons can be removed by this ammonium. Clear? So, here glutamine is the source of ammonia. Remember this. Very, very important. By the action of glutaminase, glutamine will produce ammonia. Glutaminase enzyme is also present in the liver because glutamine is also coming from the brain, right? That will come to liver to produce ammonia in liver also. In ureotelic animals means those animals which excrete urea in the urine. Okay, carbamyl group are transferred to. Okay, the question is a tricky one. They are just asking that what is the next substrate for the carbamyl phosphate in the reaction? Carbamyl phosphate reacts with what? That's what they are asking. Carbamyl phosphate reacts with ornithine. Simple, right? See, for a simple question, they are twisting it. Hydrolysis occurs at which step of urea cycle? In urea cycle, see, which is a hydrolysis step? See this, arginine is hydrolyzed to urea and ornithine. Okay. Allosteric activator of carbamyl phosphate synthase 1, CPS1, it is your NAG, N-acetyl glutamate. Which is the activator for synthesis of this this thing? Arginine. Okay. Which of the following is used as an ammonia scavenger in urea cycle disorders? So, in urea cycle disorders, we see hyperammonemia. Okay. Now, we have to remove ammonia. How will we remove ammonia? We give substances like benzoyl CoA. What will benzoyl CoA do? It will undergo phase 2 conjugation reaction with glycine to produce cupuric acid, which can be easily excreted in the urine. Is there any benzoyl CoA in the option? No. So, there must be something else. Let us see. Phenyl butyrate is converted into phenyl butyric acid and it undergoes beta oxidation to produce phenyl acetate. This phenyl acetate binds to glutamine to produce phenyl acetyl glutamine, which will be excreted in the urine. The advantage of phenyl acetate over benzyl CoA is benzyl CoA binds to glycine. Glycine contains one amino group, but phenyl acetate binds to glutamine. Glutamine contains two ammonia. So, two ammonia can be excreted. Okay. So, this is the advantage. The answer is phenyl butyrate. Which of the following urea cycle reaction takes place in mitochondria? Two reactions takes place in the mitochondria, that are initial two reaction, CPS1 and OTC. CPS1 is not there, OTC is there. Okay. So, with this, we conclude disposal of amino group and urea cycle disorders.